I've got Ian and Mark. Ian is a 18 handicap hooker of the ball, and Mark is a 13 handicap slicer of the ball. So they didn't see too much of the golf course, did you guys? Well, you see a lot of the golf course, but not too much of each other yet, plonker. He'd sort of be away quick, snatch it, and oh, he might hit one of them. Wear out, cut to ripples in the water. Who's done the button up with my trousers? Sweep it away, down and through. And you see I've got this ball nicely up into the air and into the lake. Hits it flat. Really keep those knees solid. Club face is square. It's club head, shoulders. And it's a peach. I don't know what I'm talking about. Well, I think that's enough from the lighter side from Faults and Fixes. Hello there, I'm Nick Faldo, and welcome to my latest golf instructional program. Now, it's an old adage that practice makes perfect, and that applies especially to golf. But many club golfers practice without knowing what area of the game it's helping them with, if anything at all. More often than not, all they're doing is just enhancing their faults. Now, I've designed here a series of tips and drills to put the fun back into practice, with the added bonus of not having to hit thousands of golf balls to do so. So you may be wondering why I'm introducing this program from in this room. Well, we don't solely have to be out on the golf course to improve our game. In this room here, I've got a lot of different objects which can help me with my swing. This is not one of my son Matthew's golf clubs. This is one of mine. I've taken a 9-iron here and I've cut it down to 2 feet, because obviously when I'm indoors and wanting to do some practice swinging, quite often I don't have an 8-foot high ceiling and it's a pretty cramped space. So as simple as that, it really does help you in the room every morning to get the feeling of what you want to work on during the day and free your swing up and get yourself warmed up. Another great tip for warming up is I get down onto my knees here. Because as we will talk so much about the solidity of the knees, if you can make them your solid base, then as you turn your backswing, you're going to really feel that stretch. This is a great warm-up for you. You can really feel that stretch in the lower back. So take it around slowly in the morning, and a great way of visualizing the plane of the swing, because now it's such a short club. If you did this with a full-length club, your arms would be out too straight. So the fact is only 2 foot long. My arms are actually hanging in exactly the same position as they would be for a full golf club. So as I said, great to turn round, gets you on plane, and then turning through, it's a little more difficult, but again, it's great for that stretch, you see, to stretch this right side to simulate the follow through. Now I'm often asked, how still should I keep my head during the backswing? Well, this is about the only way I think you can visualize it. Stick your head against a pillar or into the door frame, take your stance. As you work your left shoulder back and under, you can see you can keep it quite still. And as you work back through, when you get past impact position, now the right shoulder is going to collect the chin, you see. And as you pull through, you let it go with it. The last thing I want you to do is try and stay there, because what would happen, you'll block yourself and you're going to hit the ball straight right. So the right shoulder hits the chin and collects it. That's the best visualization I can give you. Let's roll two drills now into one. One for the leg action, one for the arm action. Now, you've got a sofa here. Now, what I want you to do is put your knees into the sofa, right? Take a normal address position with your arms, with your grip apart. And then I then want you to put your left hand over the top of the right hand, so you've got the two backs of the hands together. Now, as you take your backswing, that's going to help you get some rotation here. As this right hand moves round, it's going to pull the left forearm. So that's our backswing tip. And you see what happens if I do this incorrectly with my legs. You see I get to that reverse pivot position where the left leg shoots forward and the right knee's coming back. So what we're trying to do is keep some light pressure into the sofa here. So as I rotate, they stay there. Now it's automatically made me move over to the right side. And this is a great position to help you visualize getting over onto your right side. Then on the downswing, where it can help you, is the people who make their right leg move too quickly, obviously, they would go and ram it into this over here. So what we're trying to do is make the right knee slide towards the left knee. We don't want it shooting into the sofa here. So that will slide over in a nice straight line. We rotate the arms again through to our follow through. Now I think if you put those two together, that's really going to help you. Now here's a really simple little exercise you can do with putting your left leg up against the side arm of the sofa here. So many people have too much lateral sway into the ball, where those knees really move too much. Now, obviously, if you've got something to brace against it, this is a visualization you want to have in your swing, because what it will do is this braces and stays straighter, it makes the top half of the body work so much faster. So it's as simple as that. You just keep swinging away and you'll feel how much more this right side's getting to the ball, which is obviously going to help you from if you were coming across the ball so much and you never got through it, see that right shoulder stays back. So there we go, really release that right shoulder, and I think that will really help you. Now let's check a few points in our swing using the mirror. And let's start with our stance. Now if you stand directly square to the mirror, when you take your stance and then hold a club up, which will hang dead straight, obviously you can look, and if you're leaning too much to the right, obviously you've got your weight too much on your right side, vice versa, if you're left of the shaft here, too much on the left side. So it's really important that you're getting your weight nice and even, your spine pretty straight to that. What that will give you then is your left hip should be slightly higher than the right, and obviously the left shoulder will be again slightly higher than the right. So you set up and check that you've obviously got good ball position. Your hands might be a little bit too much this way, or you might be too far forward. Again, you're trying to create that good looking picture right there. And then what I'd like you to do is then cross your arms across, hit your shoulders with the club there like so. Now what you can check is your turn. As you turn 90 degrees, there's your first check. You're getting your weight onto your right thigh. Quite often if you were to take a swing without looking in the mirror and then see, you may be reverse pivoting. Now you see what sort of shape that's creating. Or there might be other swinger who moves the right shoulder back far too quickly and he's going to straighten the left leg too much, all sorts of things like that. Then we can move round this way, which is a great angle to check the plane of our shoulder. So as we turn here, look at the plane of that shaft. What we obviously don't want to be getting too steep here, or sometimes the right shoulder moves very quickly and we're far too level. So it's really important you notice that angle that I've created there. And one more thing, while you're there, you can do your hair. Now here's a really simple little exercise which checks two parts of the swing. One, whether we're on line, and two, whether we're keeping the putter low to the ground. All I'm going to do is run the putter down the shaft. I've got a line in the centre of my putter, so that helps me. Run it down on the backswing and scrape it through on the follow through. So I'm nice and low on the backswing and I'm square on the follow through. And then all we have to do is simulate that with a golf ball. What I sometimes try and do is get the putter within a quarter of an inch of the shaft, so as I take it back I might just touch it, but then through square. That's all we've got to do. Take it back low and through square. So really nice and simple. So you can hit a couple of putts there and then have a quick check. Hear that scraping of the shaft, and then it's nice and low and through. And now you're ready for the golf course. There we've done quite a few warm-up drills inside, which sometimes can be far more important than you realise, because obviously if the weather's lousy and you can't get on the golf course, or your work doesn't give you the time, then you need to stay inside and work on your game. But now for some real fun, let's work on the range. Right. Right, let's talk about driving. The other one. Okay, a few tips about driving. The most important thing, I think, for the amateurs is getting the right amount of loft on the club for them, because there's too many clubs on the market these days which, you know, won't suit them. These drivers which only have 7 degrees of loft, very big for the ego, but very difficult to use. So the important thing is to get enough loft to suit your game, because remember, what we're trying to do is get the ball into the air, try and get a little bit of draw flight to it, which is then going to help the ball release to get maximum distance. Right, so let's now go and tee one up. Now, a question I'm often asked by amateurs is, how high should you tee the golf ball? Now, as a golden rule, what I would do is try and get half the ball above the club head. But quite often, by changing that, can really help you. On a hole, when I've got trouble down the left, I would tee a little bit lower. And also then, in the wind, a lot of people believe teeing it low will help you to keep the ball down. What can often happen is the opposite. You tee it low, you get a little steep on it, and then the ball will get up into the air and be affected by the wind. So try this as a tip. Tee it up a little bit higher. Then that other little, I guess, quirk I have in my swing that I use is I always lift the driver off the ground, because what that helps is enhances a nice, smooth, wide takeaway. Obviously, if you've got it down, I often feel taking it away on the grass, I might bump into something, catch it, and it loses the tempo. So what I'm trying to do is get that nice, smooth takeaway, because what that will help is the wind up, and then you can accelerate. If you jerk it away, you're going to lose your tempo. Now, the other thing everybody always asks is, how do I hit it 10 yards further? So what I would do is get that smooth takeaway, wind it up, and at the top of the backswing, I want you to concentrate on this right knee, try and hold that in position, and then pull the left shoulder away from that. That's your two thoughts. Hold the right knee, pull the left shoulder away, then you're going to get that sort of powerful resistance, those two forces working against each other. So you watch this. Little above the ball, solid knee, and unwind it. Solid knee, and unwind it. Here we are down on the beautiful and very challenging fourth hole of Valderrama. We've simulated a practice ground facility here for you, because I feel it's really important that you know where to practice as well as how to practice, because our hook player would really benefit if he was to go over to the right-hand side of the range to practice from, because what it will make him do is aim into the middle of the practice ground here, and it's going to encourage a sort of a slice for his game, which is going to slow down his hook. Then if we move over to the other side of the range, our slicer should stand in the left-hand corner, because what that's going to do for him, he's going to start aiming out right into the middle of the field, and that's going to encourage the club to go on that same swing path, which is going to reduce that slice. So that's I really feel a good help to get you out there. And one maybe a little silly little tip, if you practice extremely hard like I do, then you wear and tear on your equipment. And what I do is I practice with my odd clubs one day of the week, and then the next day I'd practice with my even set, for two reasons. Obviously, I get the even wear and tear on my clubs. The last thing I want to do is look down and see a 6-iron almost with a hole in it. And what it does, it eliminates the fact that I've got any favourites in my bag. I want 14 favourites in there. Well, that was a nice shot, and what I want to talk to you about that was the rotation, the re-rotation, the separation, the lateral rotation prior to supination. Or maybe we should put it a little bit simpler for you. I want to go run through now a few of the thoughts and the feelings I've had over the last few years to build the golf swing, and then give you a lot of tips as I run through the swing on how to build that swing and how to keep checking it. Now, let's first of all start with the grip. A lot of people try to take the grip with the club out in front of them square and are not too sure how to put the hand, the first hand, your left hand onto it. And one simple way I found of helping this is how your hands hang naturally by your side. They're automatically turned in a little bit. So what we do is we start from a square club face and then move that club head round right in front of your right toe. Then when you apply your left hand, your left thumb automatically goes to the right of center of the grip. Now when you hold it back up, look, perfect. You've got it going parallel through the hand here and you've got this V pointing at your right shoulder. So we're off to a good start there. Then when I set up, I take a normal stance, try and keep my feet shoulder width apart. First tip is where to put the weight on your feet, and that's got to be on the balls of your feet. That's going to make your legs feel lively. We want some solid knees, about shoulder width apart. Those are the important things. So we take our address there, we bend from the hips forward. And then we let our arms hang. A lot of people say, well, how much do they hang and everything? Well, a simple checkpoint to get all this in sync. If you put the club, you hold the club here, in the middle of your shoulder, it should fall somewhere through the middle of your knees and look straight into the balls of my feet. So that means I've got my weight nice and even. I'm not too far over the top here, or if I'm way too back here, you can see. So what I'm trying to get is a nice central weight line. Right, and then moving the club away first. I really think that's the best tip to get things moving. The club head's got to travel the furthest, so we better get that moving first. So if that moves and pulls everything round, we then get ourselves into this set position. We've completed really almost a swing. And our plane check from that position is just slide the hands down and then check where that grip is pointing. And it should be, if I put a ball midway between my foot and the ball, that grip should be pointing pretty close to that ball. Now I'm on plane for the backswing. Now all I've got to keep doing now is turning the shoulders and moving the weight onto my right leg. So if I keep coiling up, I've now made a very good backswing. Notice the wrist position is exactly the same as I started. I haven't all of a sudden cupped it this way or tried to arch it over to shut the club face. It's nice and neutral. A good tip when you take a practice swing is the club should be pointing to the left of the target, a little bit laid off, because obviously on a full swing you're going to wind it up and hopefully get that pointing exactly on plane. Now remember, when you get to the top of the backswing, the importance of really keeping these knees solid. We've got to have some resistance in that, because if you wind up and knees move, you know, to your friends you look like you've made a nice backswing, you've wound up but you've created no coil, and these legs are going to cause you a lot of problems. So resist and wind it up. So let me now talk about my thoughts on the downswing. So as we've just been saying, I've wound it up, so let's unwind it coming down. So the arms start to unwind. The biggest thing we will try to work on here is getting this distance between the right hand and the right shoulder. We want that getting greater. Straight away is the first move. Now if we can pull that down to this area here, then we can then commit the whole of the right side, and it works from the top working down. We commit the right shoulder, which pulls the right hip, which then pulls the knee, which then pulls the heel off the ground. So the right shoulder commits itself to impact. Now you can see from here, often a misconception of getting to impact, everybody thinks you should be dead square. In fact, you've got to get everything open. The hips and shoulders are open, because what we're trying to do is create a path through for the arms to swing so they can release through, and you can really then commit yourself to pulling right through to make a good follow through. But the most important thing is, you know, speeding up all the time. We want a bit of zip on the bottom of the ball there and then really pull it through to a nice finish with my stomach facing the target. So let me demonstrate one of those. Wind up, unwind. Resist and wind it up. Wind up, unwind. Let's work on a few drills now to accentuate those points. Well, we really emphasize the importance of trying to keep that knee action solid, and this is where this fella comes into its own. It's our famous beach ball trick, where we stick the ball between our knees, and what we obviously this is going to do is trying to maintain the bit of solidity down there. Obviously, if we move around too much, start swaying, we're going to drop the thing. So get him solid. I've teed the ball up to make life easier. So as I take a normal backswing, I'm going to obviously keep my knees really solid so I grip him into position. Then to be correct on the downswing, as the left side moves away, we drop the ball, then continue through and hit it. So if you add that to your practice, when you start to lose that feeling of keeping those knees solid, just hit half a dozen balls like that, and that will get the firmness back, and then we can move on to the next drill. The preset drill. This is probably my first drill I ever did. It's obviously one of my favorites because what it did for me was really give me some confidence on my backswing. When I was working so hard in changing my swing, I needed something, I needed a boost. So when I got to the top of the swing, I knew I was in the right position. So let me show you how you do this. It's got to be done absolutely correctly to get the full benefit out of it. So we take our normal address position. I've teed the ball up for these exercises because striking the ball is not the most important thing here. We want to learn to teach the body these new positions. So take my address. Now what I'm going to do is set my hands here without moving them backwards, right the way to the full set position, and you can see two important things. One, the shaft is exactly in line with the one on the ground there, and it's also exactly horizontal. Now, if we go to this sort of position then start to turn, it's going to be incorrect. Or if we pull it too much inside, incorrect again. These are absolute musts, and from here I can see this one quite clearly. And this, the horizontal one may take a little bit of time to double check, but once you get the feel of this one being parallel to the ground, you've got it. So set the wrist there, and then all we have to do now is just continue turning. Just turn those shoulders, left shoulder under, and then look at that. That's the best top of the backswing position you're ever going to be in your life. Absolutely spot on. So let's bring it back down again. So we wind it up simply with the shoulders turning, moving the weight to the right. We've got it absolutely spot on. Now what we will do is hit it from that position. We will set it to there, check everything for a split second, turn and release. We'll set it to there, check everything for a split second, turn and release. Now, I used to do that till the cows came home. Right, you may all be wondering why I've pulled my left foot back almost behind my right foot. Now this is another great drill to help you get the weight onto your right leg. This is something I constantly have to work on. Our slice play, remember, if you're so much forward on the left side here, he's never got his weight onto his right leg throughout the backswing. And our advanced play, who has a very active leg action on the downswing, what we're trying to do is keep a little bit of weight there as you start down, to hold it back, as we call it. So you can start down, keep the weight on the right side, then release it through, because he's been so active and he's gone so quickly. So what you've got to do is pull this left foot all the way back so the toe is level with the back of the heel, and then lift your heel off the ground. That also makes things easier to turn, but it also pushes a little bit more weight here. Remember, still keep the weight on the ball of the feet here. Right, and take your, get yourself comfortable. It's a little bit difficult to get in that position, but as you move over, you see the weight will now stay right on that right thigh. That's the important thing, and as you start down, you're going to have to keep it there, otherwise you're going to fall over. And then you go ahead and hit through. And we're not too worried about the strike, because you know it's quite a difficult stretch to get through the ball. The most important thing is the wind up and then that unwind. So you watch that right thigh and see if I can keep it in position going back and through. As you can see, that's quite a difficult drill, so let me just hit one more of those. And let me add that even though you do feel sometimes your weight is on your right thigh, you can be twisting a little bit too much and you lose that sensation. So try and keep your chest forward over the ball, so you're not going to lose by coming back on it and twisting around. So keep nice and straight over it. So it's important to get yourself comfortable here. So you get your weight there. Right, wind it up, keep the right thigh and release. Wind it up, keep the right thigh and release. Now that's great. Now we really work hard on our leg action there. Now I've got a tip for you and a new drill to work on this right arm. Now this is the move I call my right arm separation. This is a really important part to my game. Obviously, being a tall person, when I start my downswing quite often, I come down here, I don't get any separation here, and I get jammed into my right side. So what I'm trying to achieve is to get this distance between my right hand and right shoulder greater straight away, a nice and smooth transition. So as I start down, I want to get the club moving out and then release it. And what will happen if you have a few practice swings like this, you can't stop it from happening. It's the centrifugal force of just letting the weight of the club pull you around. You're certainly not going to stand up and go into your side. So look at the ball and then just release that right hand. Make this distance get greater straight away. Now I recommend if you're a high handicapper, you just wander along the rough and you just practice this. Just stand there, clipping the top off the daisies. Get the feeling of that separation and really releasing that club head. That's going to give you so much more club head speed. And for the better golfers, why don't you try one like this? Right, wind up and separate. Wind up and separate. Now that's a great feeling if you can get that right. Now it may look to you as if I'm taking 5 minutes out while a guy set up the cameras for the next shot, but in fact I'm practicing my golf swing.
Oh no you're not!
Oh yes I am, because the right hand release is one of the most difficult things to teach, and standing here skimming the stones, you look, there's two very important parts. You watch the leg action, you watch the right hand, because it's a very difficult thing to teach you to how to release it. Everybody's going to be slightly different timing, but you watch these two legs, see how they brace themselves, and then you watch how I release it. And it's exactly the same on the golf course. And let me explain to you why. There's two things I want you to look at. Watch my leg action and watch my right arm. Now if I release my legs too early, what will happen? You watch. My palm of my hand is pointing left and it's exactly where the golf ball's gone. If I block myself with my legs, and obviously with the top half, watch what happens. Palm of the hands facing to the right, the ball goes straight right. So I've got to hold those knees solid and then release that right arm. Look at that, straight down the fairway. Right now we're going to show you skimming of the stones, throwing the golf ball, swinging the golf club in a slow motion sequence, which demonstrates perfectly the right hand release. I bet you can't spot the difference. Right, and finally, we've done an awful lot of work on the practice ground, and quite often we get bogged down with the theory. So for now, let's just concentrate on striking that golf ball. So just take out a 9-iron, and all we want to work on is the half backswing. Just set it up, really work on some zip at the bottom of the ball there, really get some sound, and then halfway through. So half set, zip it and through. So let's really crunch it and see if we can put some backspin on that ball. Set and zip it. Let's hit another one of those. So really just concentrate on the bottom half. We're just going to swing this club head. Let's forget about all the theory and get some club head speed going. Set and zip it. Well, that just about wraps up the drills. Now, the best way for you to use that when you're working on your swing is to relate to the right drill. Don't hit too many balls, just a dozen. That's going to help you regain that feeling you're looking for. Now let's work on some tips. Now, in modern golf architecture changes so much, one shot which has become far more prevalent is the long bunker shot. And there's two tips I want to give you on how you can play these shots. Often you've seen in America now, we have bunkers there which stretch all the way from the tee right away to the hole, a couple of hundred yards long. Now, let me give you 2 points to help you on that. First of all, you want to assess whether you've got a lip in front of you and what club you can clear it with. The second is the quality of the sand. If it's soft sand, then I really recommend you stick to a maximum of something like a 5-iron, because what's going to happen here is, as you make your swing, the sand's going to move a little bit, your stance is going to change, you're going to hit down and probably mishit it a little bit. So that's another important factor. The firmness of the sand, we're often seeing a lot of these waste bunkers now. If that's firm and hard packed, then you could risk that forward, because I feel that will probably help you. You can hit down behind the ball and then get it up into the air. As you can see, this is a soft base bunker, so all I'm going to try on this is a 5-iron. And let me give you a few tips what I would do in this situation. First of all, maybe choke down half an inch on the club, because obviously we want to foreshorten things, because as we dig into the sand, I'm getting half an inch closer. So that makes sense. I'm trying to keep things the same. I move the ball back in my stance quite a bit, so then I would make it then a normal backswing. And then the next thing I really try and do is really concentrate on the ball, watch the ball, really look at it hard. But as I start down, if that makes me feel like I move forward on the shot, that's a great feeling, because if you thin it a little bit, you're going to get away with that. If you hit it fat in the bunker, it's only going to go 30 yards. So move it back, normal swing, really watch it, and go forward. Move it back, normal swing, really watch it, and go forward. Now, another serious mistake I see amateurs make a lot is when their ball's in the rough, they've read so many articles about the 5-wood. This is the club to get in there and get it out. This is going to solve all your problems, but they never assess the lie or the situation. So they go wading in, give it a go, and they often hit a shot which I couldn't even attempt to play. So let me show you what will happen. They try to force it out, it's an impossible shot. Now, what I would have done in that situation is probably hit a 6 or an 8-iron. All I'm trying to do is get that ball 150 yards down the fairway back into play for one shot. I recommend you do that too. Right. Whoa. Now, how many times have I seen it on the golf course with the amateurs making a really poor, sloppy practice swing and then expecting themselves to walk up to the shot, make a perfect swing and hit a good shot with so much bad muscle memory? So it's really important that when you make your practice swing, you're trying to imitate what you're going to then do with the shot. If you're then working on a bit of stretch, get it all correct. Work on your feet, make sure you've made a good stance. You know, obviously you're away from the ball. Make a good stance, picture what you're working on, check it out, and swing through. Then that will help you to visualize what you're trying to do with the shot, then get straight in and hit the shot. Then what I often see after that is, they've hooked it into the trees, they go, oh, I say, oh, I just gave it all of this, and I've hooked it there. They've rehearsed it again, more muscle memory, more bad muscle memory. So what you should do after that, I think, I need to get over here a little bit more, check that position again, and through, right. Now I've got it right, I'll hit a good one next time. Okay, let's start with a few tips on how to hit the ball high and low. And obviously when we've hit the ball off the fairway into the trees, this is when we can use that to best effect. Now, for this shot here, obviously I'm I've got a couple of trees in front of me and I want to try and get over the top of those, but I also want to try and get some distance up the fairway towards that green. I mean, I could just sand wedge it over them, but as I said, I need to get further up to the green. So let me show you what you can do. I've got a 6-iron here, which if I was to hit that normally, would probably go straight into the tree. So let me show you a few of the little tips that I can do and swing changes to get that ball really high into the air. So there's your normal stance. So what I want you to do is obviously move the ball well ahead of center, somewhere towards your left toe here. Put a little bit more weight onto the right knee. Then really open that club face up. You've obviously got a guess by looking at the face, the trajectory it's going to take to get over the top of the tree. So just keep opening it up till you feel you're comfortable. The important bit is you really stay back on this right leg, and as you swing through the shot, again, you want to be staying behind it. You really get the feeling of behind and helping it up, and you've obviously got to be committed to the follow through. You can't just stop on this. Really pick it off the turf and hit it up. So ball forward, open the face. Now really watch it. And I've got him out of trouble and back into play. Ball forward, open the face. Now really watch it. Now here's a situation I'm sure you found yourself in before, and especially at Valderrama, under these beautiful cork trees, any time a shot leaves the fairway, this is the problem you're going to face. And if I'm trying to play a punt shot under the trees here, first thing you need to check, we've got a branch in the middle of our backswing. So obviously we're going to need to choke down to shorten that backswing. That's going to help us tremendously. Then we move the ball back in our stance, and obviously we've got to judge the trajectory we're trying to get. Now, what a lot of people will do, the mistake they will make is try to hit it low, they automatically grab, say, their longest iron, a 3-iron. Then they move it back as well, and look, quite often you smother the shot completely and you won't even get out of the rough. So probably a 5-iron's enough. Move that back towards your right foot here. As we saw by choking down, I know I'm comfortable from that branch, I can take a full swing. Then on the follow through, as we've demonstrated with the skimming of the stones, this is when this right hand comes into action, because if you picture the right hand releasing under the branches, that is exactly where the golf ball is going to go. So let me show you. Ball back and release it low. Well, from this situation, I'm pretty pleased with that one. Ball back and release it low. Now, I think we'd all agree this is the most difficult shot in golf, the 90-yard bunker shot. Now, I'll give you a few tips on how I would approach this. Number one, I think you need to take a club when you're going to make a full swing, a full natural swing, but not a forced swing in any way, because I think what that will do will keep the tempo nice and even. It's the most difficult shot to play when you've got a half swing and you're just trying to pick it off the sand. Right, then into some tips on my technique. Number one, I would strengthen my grip a little bit, because what we're trying to do is move the ball way back in our stance, almost off our right toe, square club face, we line it up directly in line with the pin there. Now on the backswing, I want you to get a more rounded feel to your backswing, because we don't want to get steep on it at all, trying to help it out of the sand. So get a more rounded, flat backswing. And then from there, just really watch the ball and then chase through the sand after it. We've got to commit ourselves to that follow through. So let me run through those. Dig those feet in, ball right back, nice flat backswing. Now remember to keep that tempo nice and even, and you might get a result like that one. Ball right back, nice flat backswing. Right, the famous towel drill. You've obviously seen this one before, but over the years, people have taken this one much too far. When we did it before, it was to link the body and arm action on no more than an 8-iron. And I see too many people thinking, well, if Nick fired it with an 8-iron, I'll do it with my driver. It's going to be far better. In fact, it's causing all other problems. But what I use it now for is for pitching. And I think this is one of the most best drills that I can help an amateur in linking that body and arm movement. Because so many people, what they will do, the arms will go first, and obviously if you'd lose the towel here, or the body and everything just are not in sync. So what we've got to do here now, because we've got the contact from the towel, is to turn the stomach and arms, and they will all link together. So that's all you've got to do. Have a couple of practice swings back and through, and just follow it through. Now, on the backswing, just let your arms rotate, so make sure you get a nice plane on the backswing. Don't get too stuck here and lifty on it at all. Obviously, you'd be way too sharp. So let the arms rotate there, look, and check that plane on the backswing, and then put it all together, back and through. There you go, and you see how well I can link that together. This really helps the amateur to get the ball airborne for the first time. Instead of trying to pick it off the ground, or just not 100% sure how hard to hit it, you can use your chest here to regulate the speed of the swing. So, chest back and through. Back and through. Now let me give you a few tips on how I work on my feel with my short game. Quite often I see on a putting green on the golf course somebody with a bag of balls just hitting 50 balls just to one spot, and the problem is all they're really working on is their technique, and after a repetition of a few balls you lose your feel. So let me take a wedge and let me show you what I do. So I've scattered some balls out and I've got a variety of pins here. Now I think the secret is to hit one shot to each pin and to get that variety, and then you're going to get the feel of what the club will do and how the ball will react. So obviously to a front pin, I've obviously got to make the ball fly a little bit higher, so I put the ball a little bit further forward in my stance, and then I can just flop it onto the green and let the ball release, and I can learn from how much that ball's released. Yes! Well, sorry about that little outburst there. Let's move on. Now, I'm going to try for that next pin, and obviously now I want to make the ball run and release a little bit more, so all I simply do is move the ball back almost towards my right toe. There's no golden rules to this. You move it about how you feel suited, how you feel comfortable, what you visualize the ball doing. So let's put it back to my right toe. Little tip on technique, all I'm trying to do is get these, work it all from the right shoulder. That moves up and through and keeps some tempo. So off the right toe, bump it forward, and then it runs forward again. And then obviously if I want to make it run even further, I've got a back pin there. I can even shut the face a little bit on this one and even maybe swing a little bit from the inside out. And that's going to help again to make the ball release. There we go, and that's working nicely. And then you can maybe visualize that this last pin has got a bit more of a hump to it maybe, and you've got to work the ball a little further up. So I could work it, ball a little further forward again in my stance, maybe open the face this time, take it a little bit outside, get a little bit more chop, a little bit more bite onto it. So what I want you to do is to work with one club and visualize the shot, see the shot and have one go at it, and then you're going to get some feedback of how the green reacts and what your limitations are with that club. Right, take for example now we've got a bad lie, a ball sitting down. You know, you've thrown them out. Don't cheat now and roll it into a good lie. We need to learn from this situation. And if I'm going to try and get across the other side of the green, obviously I need to hit down on this ball, get a little steeper angle of attack. So hit down and through. That's all right. Now, that's the only way you can learn from this. I can't teach you feel. You've got to come out with one club, throw the balls out, and then and work to these pins. And one shot at a time, you're going to get some feedback on that because you only get one chance on the golf course. Right, now, what I'm often asked by amateurs is how they can judge the distance of a pitch shot on the green and what sort of club to use, when to change and everything. Now, some of the golden rules that I stick to is what we're trying to do is get the ball onto the green first, because we know that surface, that's the best surface on the golf course. Hopefully we will know how it's going to react, how much it's going to run. So it's very important we get our first bounce onto the green and then let it release and then see what it happens. And obviously if we use a variety of clubs, that's going to lengthen things out towards the pin. So I'm going to put a couple of markers down. So if I'm going to try and get it on, give myself a foot margin there and maybe a yard and a half, something like that. Now if I can land each club, each different club here in that area, it's going to show you how much difference roll we're going to get. So first of all with the sand wedge, obviously this would be for a close pin. So let's just land it in between there. Good, now you can see how that started to bite. So I move up to the pitching wedge now, which is obviously about 6 degrees less loft than a sand wedge. Same spot. There we go. That goes on another 10 feet or so further. Move on to the 8-iron. Pick my spot again. See, that's all I'm in control of this. Now all I'm trying to do is move the ball 3-4 yards. And now if I have a go with the 6-iron, land it probably just 1 yard onto this green, we'll make it down to the pin there. There we go, perfect. Now you can see this is so much easier for you to take a sand wedge and try and loft it and land it in between that pin there. Impossible for you to judge. I'd find that really tough, but the fact I can look at a spot, I know Isao Aoki is an absolute magician at this. He picks a spot right in front of him and he really concentrates on that, hits down onto that spot and lets the ball release to the hole. Now I want to give you a simple tip to cope with these four different situations we've got here in the bunker. I've got soft sand, hard sand, a downhill lie and an uphill lie. Now simply by changing the weight from my right leg to left leg to suit these shots, I can cope with all these situations. Now as you know, if you've got a basic know-how of the bunker shot, then as I said, all we need to do is then work on the weight. For a soft sand, as you walk in, obviously you dig your feet in. That's the only way you can sense the depth of the sand. So if it goes down quite a way, then you think, right, this is soft sand one. So simply move your weight onto your right foot. Now what that will do is obviously give you a sort of a shallower attack into it. You won't be digging down so much. You won't be taking so much sand. And you stay in that situation there. So weight on the right side. Back and through. There we go, cope with that one. And then we can then go to an opposite of that. We're now on a downhill lie, quite a severe downhill lie. What I want to do on this one, obviously I've got to cope with that slope. We're going to use the same stroke, but I'm going to put an awful lot of weight onto my left foot now. So right foot becomes pretty light. So I set up very similar, but put a lot of weight there. Same backswing. There we go, that one was all right. Let's go to the other extreme. This ball's under the lip here a little bit. I'm on an uphill lie, so all I need to do now is put that weight back onto that right leg, lean back behind it, and stay there. And obviously I'm gonna have to hit this quite hard to get him out. And then back to the firm sand. As we said before, the soft sand, as you put your feet in, you think, wow, look, I haven't got more than an eighth of an inch here, so it's gonna be firm. So I put my weight onto the left leg, because what that's going to do is give me a much steeper attack. Same swing, just steeper angle of attack, and down and through. So left leg, down and through. So there we go, quick summary. Soft sand, weight on the right leg. Hard sand, weight on the left. Downhill lie, weight on the leg also. Uphill lie, weight on the right. Anytime you go to a golf course for the first time, one of the hardest things to adapt to is the speed of the greens, and it's a very important part of it. And let me show you a couple of tips what I would do. As you saw, I've just hit about a 25 foot downhill putt, so let's turn straight round again and hit it back up the hill. Obviously I've got to hit it a lot harder to get that feel. So What I want you to do is go up and down a couple of times. That's going to give you a good feel of a medium distance putt. And one other little drill I really enjoy is I put the balls out probably somewhere between 6 and 10 feet in between them, all the way down the green there. There we go. And then I'd start obviously from the closest one here, and all I'm worried about is getting the tempo and the feel to the greens. So the most important thing is to try and get the ball something like 2 feet past the hole as your max. So maybe if I'm lucky, I can hold the first one, but after that, let's start working on the feel. So make sure we get it up just past the hole. That was a good one. Obviously now getting a bit longer, and all this is doing for you is getting the feel, and the feel comes from your right hand. That's the most important one. So keep that tempo in the stroke, 1, 2, but it's the feel you get in the right hand. And right the way up to the longest one. Now let me show you one more tip for those dreaded knee knockers. What I want you to do here, and you can only do this on the putting green, not on the golf course, is take your address and then push the ball into the hole. No backswing at all. Because what that's going to help you do is go straight through to your target. If that putter head doesn't do that, if it de-accelerates at all, was any hesitation, you're going to pull it left, miss it on that left edge. Or if it's a little bit jerky and a little bit too much sort of right hand, whoop, you're going to miss it on that right edge as well. So just quickly recap on him, squaring up and then push him straight into the hole. Well, that just about wraps things up on this tips and drills video. I really hope you've enjoyed it. I'm sure you can get a lot of benefit out of some of those tips. And on a personal note, I've really enjoyed doing some of those drills. I've had to revamp them from a few years ago. And I bet you'll see me doing those on the next coming tournament. So with it being such a beautiful evening here at Valderrama, I think I'm going to stick around and have a putt. So thanks for joining me, and good golfing.